Comrade Joseph, Comrade Tom Panikal, Comrade Abdul Khader, MLA from Gurwayur, IP Shane, Comrade Madhu, your news editor. Girija's name is also here in the list, but I don't see her. Is she here? Yeah. Because Girija and Shashi, we have known each other for the last 40 years or so when they were working in Delhi. So we are otherwise also close friends and my dear comrades. You asked me to speak upon, the importance of the struggle against the fascistic agenda. The first point you must understand here is the, what is the importance of this struggle? I mean, why is this fascistic agenda to be struggled against? At one level, it requires to be struggled against because it is the entire antithesis of democracy. It is the antithesis of the individual rights to liberty, fraternity, and equality. Because fascism, as has been scientifically described, and I think the, till date, the most scientific analysis of the nature of fascism, its character, and the rise of fascism, has been done by Georgi Dimitrov for the 7th Congress of the Third International, with the rise of Hitler and Mussolini and the fascist war looming large in 1935, where he says fascism is not the succession of one bourgeois government by another. Fascism is the replacement of the parliamentary democracy by an open terroristic dictatorship. So fascism is not merely a replacement of political parties that are in controlling power in any bourgeois setup. It is the replacement of a system itself. Parliamentary democracy is replaced by an open terroristic dictatorship. By definition, therefore, fascism is anti-democratic. Anti all the values that, let's say, in the Indian context, our Indian constitution promises as fundamental rights to our citizens of liberty, equality, fraternity, etc., etc. So therefore, the fight against this fascistic agenda is essential if we want to maintain India as a secular democratic republic. So the importance lies, number one, in maintaining India as we know of it today in our constitution. Even that is being eroded. I'll come to it later. To maintain it as a secular democratic republic. Secondly, fascism also produces a degree of social animosity that leads to virtual extermination of a certain minority which fascism considers it as its enemy. The fascistic tendency in India, for instance, the RSS, which has a fascistic agenda, this is what the CPIM's party program states very clearly. I'll come to that later. But this fascistic agenda, their leaders declared right at the beginning, is not realizable. That is, the fascistic agenda contained in their conception of what they call the Hindu Rashtra. The RSS conception of what they call the Hindu Rashtra. This, they say, the three internal enemies who are stopping the achievement of this establishment of this Hindu Rashtra are the Muslims, the Christians, and the communists. So the inherent nature of fascism is not only anti-democratic, anti-secular replacement of parliamentary democracy by an open terroristic dictatorship, but it is also anti-specific groups within the society, like it was the Jews in Hitler's fascistic Germany. In India, you have, because of our sheer size and diversity, the Muslims, the Christians, and the communists who are the internal enemies. So fascistic agenda succeeding means increasing strife, social strife, leading to the virtual extermination of certain types of population who are legitimate citizens of our country according to the existing constitution. Thirdly, the fascistic agenda, by seeking to jettison parliamentary democracy, undermines the already fragile rights and obligations that the Indian state has to its own people, as promised in our constitution. That is, instead of taking this constitution forward towards giving more fundamental rights and freedoms to the people, which can happen only in a people's democratic stage. For instance, as an example, today the right to employment is not a fundamental right in our constitution. But for the youth of our country and for the betterment of our own country, the right to employment must be a fundamental right. The right to health is not a fundamental right in our constitution, but it must be made a fundamental right. The struggle, therefore, is to improve this constitution into a better constitution. What the fascistic agenda does is to retard this constitution into even undermining whatever little that is promised under this constitution. And that is important to understand, because somebody was mentioning it to me. Why are you such a big champion of the Indian constitution today? When EMS Nambudripa used to give lectures attacking the Indian constitution. I said, even today I'll also give those lectures. I mean, we have learned from Comrade EMS's lectures of attacking the constitution. That was, what was the perspective? This constitution must be made even better. This constitution doesn't give the basic right to life. It's not a fundamental guarantee. It doesn't guarantee fundamentally to our children a basic level of nutrition so that they can grow up in a proper and a healthy manner. All these rights have to be incorporated into the constitution, that is, change the constitution for the better. The fascist agenda is to change the constitution for the worse, eventually to give up this constitution and to have an open terroristic dictatorship. So in that sense, fascism, the fascistic agenda aims at a regression of the achievements of the struggle of the Indian people. This constitution is the product of the struggle of Indian people. This is not the charity of any bourgeoisie. People's struggles is what made us reach this stage where this constitution could be adopted. Now, this being undermined will lead eventually to the undermining of parliamentary democratic structure itself in our country, leading to the open terroristic dictatorship. Fourthly and finally, what is the importance of fighting this fascistic agenda? Any progressive change, any change for the improvement, any change for creating a better India, any change for moving towards an India which is a society without any exploitation of man by man, that is towards socialism. This movement is based on the intensity and intensification of the class struggle. That can only happen if we are able to unite the most exploited classes in our society into a formidable political force that can challenge the class rule of the present bourgeois landlord classes. That unity, the most exploited sections are who? The working class, under its leadership, the agricultural laborer, and the poor peasantry. These three classes today constitute, in class terms, and in social terms, it is in these three classes that most of the socially oppressed sections of India also find their place. Whether Dalits or it is the tribals, or it is the marginalized groups, they are either members of the working class, the poor peasantry, or the agricultural labor. Nearly 90% of agricultural labor in our country is Dalits and your Adivasis. It is this unity which has to be stronger in order to achieve that social change. The fascistic agenda divides that very unity in the name of religious communalism. The unity of the working class, which we seek to build to change our society in a better manner, that unity is disrupted by dividing the working class in terms of the Hindu working class, the Muslim working class, or the Christian working class. And instead of uniting this for a social change, you are disrupting this unity, which facilitates the emergence of fascism. So that is why today, for all these four counts, for one, to safeguard what we already have achieved in our country in terms of our secular democratic constitution. Two, to safeguard the parliamentary democratic system that we have that provides us some rights or the others. Three, to safeguard the struggle in order to change this constitution and system for the better, rather than taking it back, which the fascistic agenda wants. And fourthly, to move forward for a more fundamental change in our society, moving towards a society free of exploitation of man by man, that is socialism. The unity of those exploited classes, which is the basic force to achieve this objective, that itself gets divided. So the importance lies, therefore, of fighting this fascistic agenda, the importance lies in what we want to do with our own country, with ourselves, and what you want to leave for our children. What sort of a system do we want? Do you want a better India, or do you want an India to go back into the darkness of the past? That is finally the choice. The light of the future or the darkness of the past? That is to encapsulate in a single sentence, that is the fight that needs to be waged against the fascistic forces today. Now, if that is the case, does this Modi government represent fascism? No, as I said, fascism is the replacement of parliamentary democracy by an open terroristic dictatorship. Now, that has not yet happened in our country. Parliamentary democracy is being undermined. And we see it more nakedly in the parliament when you sit there, whenever they don't want anything to be stopped in the Rajya Sabha, they'll declare that particular legislation as a money bill so that Rajya Sabha can be avoided. Such manipulation is there, and it's a serious manipulation because people seldom understand the constitutional scheme that constitution has. What is the meaning of, let's say, we the people? We start the constitution by saying we the people. We end the preamble by saying give ourselves and enact this constitution. The people are supreme in our constitution. That is, the sovereignty of India lies with the people. It does not lie anywhere else but the people of our country. Now, how do people exercise this sovereignty? They exercise the sovereignty through the elected representatives, either in assemblies or in the MLAs. And these legislative bodies, the executive or the government, is accountable and answerable to these executive bodies. That is, the government is answerable to the parliament, the parliamentarians are answerable to the people. And the people keep changing their parliamentarians depending on elections when they come. And it is through that process they exercise their sovereignty. In this link, people, people's representatives, government, government being accountable, the key link of this process is what? The parliament and the legislatures must function effectively. Otherwise, the government is not made accountable, the people are not answered. That is, parliamentarians are not accountable to the people, government is not accountable to the parliament. If that happens, the sovereignty of the people breaks down. The whole constitution breaks down. So undermining of the parliamentary democracy is one classic way of undermining this entire constitutional scheme of things. And that is essential for facilitating the transition towards an open terroristic dictatorship of fascism. But that has not yet happened. But does it mean, therefore, that this is not fascism. So therefore, an erroneous understanding that is coming is that you quote from Dimitrov to say that this, which, what is fascism, and therefore since this is not fascism, the need to fight fascism or fascistic trends gets undermined. Why I say this? One is the replacement of parliamentary democracy by an open terroristic dictatorship. Why does this situation arise? When Dimitrov analyzes it, and very correctly, why does a situation arise when a parliamentary democracy has to be jettisoned and an open terroristic dictatorship has to be brought about? This arises because of a very intense crisis in global capitalism, particularly in monopoly capitalism, the leaders of the capitalist world. And in today's world, that is not only monopoly capitalism, but international finance capital. The crisis of capital, one of the best ways through which capitalism can get out of the crisis is to impose, and that is what Karl Marx has taught us, and we are celebrating the 200th year of his birth, the 150th year of the publication of Capital, the 100th year centenary of the October Revolution. This year all of them fall. So when you recall, what does Marx teach us? That capitalism emerges from every crisis by intensifying the exploitation of the people. Either the crisis can be turned into a revolutionary movement and a revolution occurs, but that requires the power of the political alternative of socialism. If that is strong, a crisis movement can be converted into a revolution. If that is weak, capitalism re-emerges from that crisis by intensifying exploitation of the people. And to re-emerge from a crisis by intensifying exploitation of the people, it requires a political order that can facilitate such exploitation, such intensification of exploitation. Fascism precisely facilitates that intensification of exploitation by eliminating all democratic rights and, most importantly, trade union rights and the rights of the collective bargaining of the working class, which is essential for intensifying that exploitation so that capitalism can re-emerge from the crisis. And historically, you go back and have a look. When did European capitalism rise? When did it assume the form of an offensive rise? In the early 1930s? When did the Great Depression, the first major global crisis of capitalism, begin? In 1929. The Great Depression begins in 1929. Capitalism is in the most intensive of its crises ever in the history till then. One response to emerge out of this crisis was the move towards fascism, in the sense which will facilitate the intensification of exploitation of the people more and more, so that capitalism can re-emerge from this crisis. And that's exactly what fascism does. That is exactly why the world's monopoly bourgeoisie, the world's biggest capitalists, have always been the great supporters and sympathizers of Hitler. I don't know if many of you know, till he died, Hitler on his study table in his office used to have a photograph of Henry Ford. Then somebody once asked him, Henry Ford, why do you have Henry Ford? He said, he is my role model. What was Henry Ford's contribution? Henry Ford was the first one to have brought in the concept of what is called the assembly line of production. Even today, even in your journalism, there's an assembly line. I mean, the reporter files, the sub-editor does, and finally, by the time it goes into the print, you have an assembly line that is there, each one assigned with their responsibilities. So he says that is exactly what is required in a society. Every individual must have its specific responsibility without questioning that needs to be done. So no question of any rights, no question of anything else, but the basic point beyond that, what was it happening? That world, the monopoly capitalists in the world found in Hitler the answer to get out of this crisis, because A, he could crack down and crush the working class movement and its bargaining power capacities so that exploitation could increase, and two, that Hitler was providing the biggest stimulus package for revival of capitalism that has ever happened in human history till then. And what was this revival package? The militarization that Hitler undertakes. The militarization of the German army, the fascist army, was the biggest order giver to the capitalist world. And every single capitalist producer gained because of this militarization. And I don't know if anyone of you, I mean, most of you must have seen what was Steven Spielberg's film? Schindler's List. You've seen Schindler's List, no? And in Schindler's List, Schindler is a businessman. He gives a list of Jews who should be spared. So the whole world thinks of him as a very magnanimous, businessman who was saving the Jews. And if you remember in the film, I don't know if Steven Spielberg noted it or it came accidentally or erroneously, there's one dialogue which says, somebody asks Schindler, saying that if you're doing all this for the Jews, why are you supporting Hitler? Then Schindler says, war and Hitler are the best that could happen to business. Without these two businessmen, none of us would have survived. So the support of big business to fascism is inherent at times of crisis when fascism rises. And the similarities today, we must note that this is the 8th year now of the global capitalist crisis, 9th year of 2008. Every single way out of the crisis they have tried, they have failed, and the crisis has become deeper. So the objective situation for maximizing profits can happen only if you have regimes which are able to suppress people's movements and suppress the class struggle that is going on in various parts of the world. And such people alone can create conditions for profit maximization. And that is why Modi becomes a very favorite leader for such forces. 3 years since Modi became Prime Minister. We used to fight against Dr. Manmohan Singh. Remember, against the Congress policies, I used to articulate also the two Indias that are being created, a shining India and a suffering India. I mean, I've been saying this so often that people in Parliament say, why are you repeating it so much? You're becoming a bore by repeating it. But I said that is exactly what is happening. No, after Manmohan Singh, in these last 3 years, what has happened? When Manmohan Singh left Prime Ministership, 49% of India's GDP was controlled by 1% of our population. Today, that 1% of our population controls nearly 60% of our GDP. So the capitalist class and the rich are very happy with this regime. Their profits are rising. But for the people, now you see growing unemployment. You see the farmers that are there on the strikes and the growing distress suicides by our peasantry. And the growth of unemployment, the growth now again of prices and the inflation now restarting, the agrarian distress, all this put together with the impact of demonetization that is now being understood by many, of how it ruined our informal economy. And all this is being, even if you take the latest, the notification on cattle trade, banning cattle trade. I was in Bangalore yesterday, an IT city. And in Bangalore, what were the advertisements? Now that the cattle trade has been banned, small slaughterhouses have been closed, order your fresh meat from 1, 2, 3, 4. You know, your, what do you call this, agencies or apps that were given. So online, you order your meat. What we could buy for 200 rupees in your street corner shop, meat shop, is now being home delivered to you in a good packaging for 450 rupees. What is happening? You're shifting all your economy and survival of your people and handing it over to big business, international capital, for their profit maximization. The same thing you did with demonetization, the thrust towards digital transactions, and the transaction cost on which the struggle is still going on even today. Today the dealers, petrol dealers, have now said that if you go on, if you go with this policy of daily changing the price of petrol and diesel, then we will close down our outlets. But all this is being done by the profits there can be maximized at the expense of the Indian people. So they find in Mr. Modi a very classic urban case where you have the advantage for big business of maximizing profits by increasing the exploitation on the Indian people, and that is sanctioned by a political authority and a political regime, and therefore this suits them that this regime should continue so that their profit maximization can continue. So therefore, what do we have? We have a situation where it is not classic fascism. In the sense, parliamentary democracy, though being eroded, has not been jettisoned. It's not been replaced by an open terroristic dictatorship. But the tendencies are fascistic. The tendencies are movements towards that. And that tendency is how fascism consolidated itself, is also through the undermining of the authority of the state structures, and in their place, replacing it with private armies. You had the Hitler's brown shirts, Mussolini's black shirts. If there's any violation of law, it is the police and the courts that must dispense justice. But it is the private armies that take upon themselves the right to implement the law. And that's exactly what your cow protection committees or gau raksha committees that have come up in all the BJP-led states are doing. And whom do they target? In our country, the Dalits and the Muslims specifically. Or you have this moral policing squad. And UP, poor Shakespeare, has also been dragged into it. The moral policing squad has been named as anti-Romeo squad. Why bring Shakespeare into it, but here in your Karnataka, you call it the Sri Ramasena. That is, what should our youngsters eat, how they should dress, whom they should befriend, how they will, with whom they'll marry, or how they'll live their life, everything they'll decide. And this menace is the methodology of how fascism seeks to consolidate itself, and that is the fascistic method. That is why when we quote Dimitrov to say that this is, to say this is not yet an open terroristic dictatorship, therefore this is not fascist, correct? But at the same time, we must be conscious, and that the CPIM is very conscious. In our party program that we have updated in 2000, we said, and I'm quoting from our CPM party program, it says, the threat to secular foundations has become menacing with the rise of the communal and fascistic RSS combined and its assuming power in the center, unquote. And then the party program says, I quote, the support of sections of the big bourgeoisie for the BJP and its communal platform is fraught with serious consequences for democracy and secularism in the country. Unquote. So CPM is conscious that this is a fascistic project. And in fact, subsequently the program says, I quote, the danger of fascist trends gaining ground based on religious communalism must be firmly fought at all levels, unquote. This is the program direction to us. And how does this fascistic forces work? The CPM program itself says, I quote, the Bharatiya Janata Party is a reactionary party with a divisive and communal platform, the reactionary content of which is based on hatred against other religions, intolerance and ultra-nationalist chauvinism. All of it you find today's condition. The BJP is no ordinary bourgeois party. As the fascistic Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh guides and dominates it. When BJP is in power, the RSS gets access to instrument of state power and state machinery. The Hindutva ideology promotes revivalism and rejects the composite culture of India with the objective of establishing a Hindu Rashtra. Besides a substantive section of big business and landlords, imperialism headed by the USA is lending all-out support to the BJP, unquote. This was in 2000. Today in 2017, we see actually the actual play of all these analysis and assessments that the CPM has made. Therefore, comrades, fascism is not something that is established over a day. And the same Dimitro, when he says, when he said, whose definition we are using to say that it is not yet fascism in India, but it is fascistic tendency. In the same speech that all of us quote, I'll quote two passages that makes it very clear the situation that we are facing in India. I'm sorry, my English is being followed or problem? Shall I speak slower or faster? One thing I can't do is speak in Malayalam. That's all, the only problem. But so the same Dimitro, what does he say? The development of fascism and fascist dictatorship itself assume different forms in different countries according to historical, social and economic conditions and to the national peculiarities and the international position of the given country. So it is not a common formula to be applied. How it rose in Germany is going to be the exact way it will rise, let's say in India or in Malaysia or in Bangladesh. But the rising of that is the reason for that is what we have discussed so far. Then it says then I think most of you should read this thing. It's not a very long speech that he make, but it's so prescient and makes us relate with everything that is happening in India today, of how exactly he says. Then he says, the accession to power of fascism must not be conceived in so simplified and smooth a form as though some committee or some finance capital decided on a certain date to set up a fascistic dictatorship. It is not the decision, let's say, of the district committee or the local committee or the Politburo. It is not a one-day decision. He says this is a process that happens. In reality, I'm quoting, fascism usually comes to power in the course of a mutual and at times severe struggle against the old bourgeois parties or a definite section of these parties in the course of a struggle even within the fascistic camp. The establishment of a fascistic dictatorship. Before the establishment of a fascistic dictatorship, bourgeois governments usually pass through a number of preliminary stages and institute a number of reactionary measures which directly facilitate the accession of power of fascism. Whoever does not fight the reactionary measures of the bourgeoisie and the growth of fascism at these preparatory stages is not in a position to prevent the victory of fascism, but on the contrary, facilitates that victory." Unquote. So this is very clear that at every stage as the fascist threat develops, through the unfolding of this fascistic agenda, unless we resist it and unless we stop that from developing, we are not only not stopping the rise of fascism, but we are actually facilitating that rise if we do not intervene to stop it. And that precisely is the stage we are in our country, my dear friends. That the BJP is the political arm of the RSS is something that does not need any great explanation. After Mahatma Gandhi's assassination, when the RSS was banned, the RSS could withdraw the ban only by promising to be a cultural organization that will not participate in politics. Since then, they were in search of a political arm. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee, who was then a member of the Nehru cabinet, resigned from the Nehru cabinet on the Hindu code bill. They did not want any reform in the religious laws. Today they are talking of uniform civil code. But Shyama Prasad Mukherjee resigned because Nehru started the process of a uniform civil code. In protest against that, when he resigned, he was searching to start a political party. And to help Shyama Prasad Mukherjee set up a political party, Golwalkar, the then Supreme Sanchalak of the RSS, sent 4 Pracharaks, amongst others. And who were these 4 Pracharaks? Deendayal Upadhyay, L.K. Advani, Atal Bihari Vajpayee, and Shyam Sundar Bhandari. He sends these 4 to Shyama Prasad Mukherjee to help set up a political party, and therefore is born the Bharatiya Janasangh. Bharatiya Janasangh and later the Bharatiya Janata Party, since then, have been nothing but the political arm of the RSS. And it is this, implementing the fascistic agenda of the RSS, the job of the political arm, and that's exactly what we are seeing. I'm not going into the details of what is happening in our country today, but if you think about it, every single area, it is the fascistic agenda of the RSS of converting the secular democratic foundations of Indian Republic into the RSS variety of a rabidly intolerant fascistic Hindu Rashtra. And that Hindu Rashtra has been defined by Golwalkar himself in a book called We or Our Nationhood, defined in 1939, where he says it's only Hindus and Hindus alone who have been masters of this country since time immemorial, who have the right to be here. All others must treat themselves as foreigners. They can live in this country only at the mercy of the Hindu nation and by accepting the supremacy of the Hindu nation. Then he goes on to say, he alone is a nationalist who promotes the cause of Hindu, of the Hindu nation. So nationalism is nothing but Hindutva nationalism. There's no patriotism. There's only promotion of the Hindu nation as the Hindutva nationalism. And in that, of course, he draws parallel to how Hitler did it with the Jews for upholding the purity of the Aryan race. I mean, this is full of so many contradictions that it'll require another lecture to actually discuss all these things. According to Golwalkar, the original inhabitants of this land are the Hindus. And who are the Hindus? The Aryans. If the Aryans were the original inhabitants of India, then who are the Aryans that Hitler was espousing in Germany? And why was he attacking the Jews? So did the German Aryans come from Germany to India, or the Indian Aryans go from India to Germany? And then to overcome this, Goldwater comes out with a very, very hilarious thesis. You see, those days your Tilak, a big Hindu leader, national leader, he was also an astronomer. So he was plotting the stars. And then he said that the position of the stars that are mentioned in your Vedic times, in your ancient times, and the position of the stars today are different. So more than the stars moving, it's likely that we have moved. In today's astronomy, they'll tell you that's correct, the principle. So if we have moved, then he came to the conclusion that the land on which we are staying is moving. A century later, plate tectonics confirms that that is correct. We are today on a moving mass, which is actually floating. And when there are different plates on which all of us are living, when two plates collide, you have earthquakes, you have mountain ranges that grow, and you know, things like that happen, and that is what the collision. So therefore Tilak said in ancient mantras that all of us Brahminical people are, we are taught before we know what is happening in the world. By the age of 11 I had to learn all these by heart. Only later I could understand some of the meaning of it, but so then Jambur Deepe Bharatadvarshe Bharatakande. You say Jambur Deep. Jambur Deep is what? A big island. Jambur Dvipam. So when, if these are the times when these mantras originated, then the land must have been an island. Later, science has shown us that that part of the Gondwana land that drifted away came and hit your central Indian plate, and that's how the Vindhya mountains emerged. Both together went and hit the European plate. That's how the Himalayas, emerged, and that's how Tibet plateau was created. Anyway, that is all science. So Tilak said the Arctic origin of the Aryans. He said Aryans came down from the, what do you call it, the southern Arctic, well, the Antarctica. From there, the Gondwana land, it moved and came here. If Tilak is correct, then Golwalkar and this RSS, Hindu Rashtra is all bogus. So then how do you manage to compromise? So he said, no, Tilak is right. It could be the Arctic origin, but the land moved from the Arctic origin and to come to where today's UP and Bihar are there. So today's UP and Bihar is the origin of the Aryans, according. Now, if the land moves, it cannot leave people behind and move, no? But people can't be hanging and then dropping somewhere. Yeah? So, this whole thing is actually a most preposterous theory, saying that Aryans are the original inhabitants. And if Aryans were the original inhabitants, then Indus Valley civilization, what are they? They said they are Aryans. If they are Aryans, then why is the script still not decipherable? Why did and how did Sanskrit come later if they were all Aryans, and Aryans were the ones who were using Sanskrit? So all these questions clearly show that it's all a mythological construct that they are creating. And having said all this, then they say that this is the only place where the Hindus and Hindus alone occupied these lands, so nobody else, everybody else is a foreigner. That is why, remember, even today the RSS BJP does not call our tribals as Adivasis. Adi means in Sanskrit Adimanav, the original. If Aryan is the original, then Adivasi can't be Adi. Aryan has to be the Adi. So the Adivasi term doesn't exist for the BJP RSS. It's the Vanavasi, the jungle dwellers. So they have the Vanavasi Kalyan Samiti, not Adivasi. So therefore the whole concept of theirs, that Muslims are foreigners, Christians are foreigners, they have come into India, but this is our land. all that vanishes into thin air when it is shown that even Aryans are the ones who came from outside to this place. So therefore they have to show that Aryans were only from here. And scientifically they have completely failed, and everybody knows that's not a fact. So if that is the case, their whole theory falls. But in order for the theory not to fall, you'll have to have this supremacy of saying the Aryavarta, and on that basis build up these myths. So that is why this fascistic agenda is also based on the creation of mythological truths, which are actually myths that are being passed off as history. Mythology is passed off as history. Theology is passed off as philosophy. And that is the danger which we'll have to fight. That is how they want to change our entire education system. Changing our entire education system and adopting the fascistic methodology. Fascist methodology, they want to advance this project of Hindu Rashtra, which I've said at the beginning, is a complete antithesis of all the revolutionary agenda that we today want to achieve in order to liberate our own Indian people from their exploitation and their oppression. And here, if you read Dimitrov, you will find six particular traits which are very interesting. I won't explain them because it will take a lot of time, but I'll just read them out and you can use your own mind to try and see how clear they are in the Indian context. He says fascism, I mean, what are the tendencies that makes fascism, how does it appeal to the masses? Then he says, fascism, I'm quoting from Dimitrov, fascism is able to attract the masses because it demagogically appeals to their most urgent needs and demands. Fascism not only inflames prejudices that are deeply ingrained in the masses, but also plays on the better sentiments of the masses, on their sense of justice, and sometimes even on their revolutionary traditions. Look at the way today he is building that world's tallest statue for Sardar Patel, the same Sardar Patel who banned the RSS. But they will appropriate the revolutionary traditions that they will appropriate. They will want to create their own new history. The other trait of fascism, Dimitrov says, a quote, I'm not giving you the examples. Any one of all of us, if you use our minds for a minute, we'll be able to relate what Modi is doing today to what Dimitrov said then. Fascism acts in the interest of the extreme imperialists, but it presents itself to the masses in the guise of the champion of an ill-treated nation and appeals to outraged national sentiments." Unquote. 3 years of Modi's rule, India has now become the official term that US imperialism uses is India is their staunchest defense partner. That we are now today the subordinate ally of US imperialism in the world in every area. Acts in the interests of extreme imperialists. That is what is being done by this government in the last 3 years. But it presents itself to the masses as the champion of an ill-treated nation. Look at Modi, every speech, most of the speeches, he says, 1200 years pehle. And going back to 1200 years before, that is before the Muslims came in here. He says, from there I have to carry the threads of our country's glory. So we have been ill-treated for all these 1200 years. Caste system in India and the prejudices were brought by the Muslim invaders into India. There was no caste in India before, according to him. So all these are brought in to show that we have been an ill-treated nation, and therefore anybody who champions the interest of this ill-treated nation is alone a nationalist. So only if you're championing Hindu nation, or a nationhood, you are a nationalist. That is why it is Bharat Mata Ki Jai, not Jai Hind. They'll never say Jai Hind. It'll only Bharat Mata Ki Jai. And they'll say, you say Bharat Mata Ki Jai. You say, why? Netaji's slogan of Jai Hind. Today, every single Jawan in our borders, when they greet each other, their greeting is Jai Hind. But Jai Hind is not nationalism. Bharat Mata Ki Jai is nationalism. And that is the point. Jai Hind is patriotism. What they are promoting is Hindutva nationalism. The struggle is between patriotism and Hindutva nationalism. And then Dimitro goes on, they're saying that fascism aims at the most unbridled exploitation of the masses, but appears before them as the and appear before them through an anti-capitalist demagogy, taking advantage of the profound hatred entertained by the toilers against the bourgeoisie, the banks, the trusts, and the financial magnates, and advancing slogans which at given movement are more alluring to the politically immature masses, unquote. Look at the entire demonetization thing. What did he say? Ye sab chore, I mean, all these are robbers, they have looted us, I am going to bring the money back and give it to you. 15 lakhs of rupees into every single account. Jandhan account. I'll open this and we'll give you the money. Were impressed. I mean, there's no denying the fact. Many people were swayed by that campaign. Now slowly they are realizing this. So the point at issue is there are various methods through which fascism consolidates itself in Europe are exactly the ones that are being used here today. So how do you fight this? Fighting this sort of fascistic agenda, as I said earlier, has to be fought on the basis of every single ideological and the theoretical constructs that fascism provides to distort the syncretic growth of Indian civilization. How the people of India evolved through the confluences of various civilizations, how this entire land evolved, and that is why this is a land of such diversity. And the Indian creativity lies precisely because of this diversity. And that is what they want to straitjacket into a uniformity. Now that is what needs to be fought at all levels when they distort the history of various religious populations in our country, when they distort the entire harmonious coexistence of various communities in our country, when they distort history to prove their point of view. I mean, basic facts, like the strongest ally of Krishna Devaraya in Hampi was Golconda of the Muslim Badshahs of Deccan. But they will present their history as saying that it was the Hindu-Muslim fight. The biggest, this entire distortion of history, distortion of syllabus, all these things have to be fought concretely at that level. And many of their, distorted versions that they are talking about today on the question of the cow, and creating the mythology, and creating a new sort of a history, which the propaganda minister of Hitler had said very clearly, if you tell a big enough lie, frequently enough, it becomes the truth. The lie has to be big, and it has to be frequently told. How do you know Rama was born in Ayodhya? A big lie, but frequently told. So even today, most of us also say, okay, if they are saying Rama is born in Ayodhya, let us accept. It becomes the truth. Slowly by assimilation. Rajeshwar Rao, former General Secretary of CPI, when we were in the student movement, he told us to come, let's go to Ayodhya Tura. When there, and we asked, he asked the youth, how do you know Rama was born here? And what was their reply? How do you know you're your father's son? Your mother told you that you're your father's son. So my mother told me Rama was born here. So what is the, what is the logic or rationale for that? That is the sort of an appeal, the emotive appeal upon which they thrive. And that has to be busted through a rational discourse with them. But most importantly, the final point that I want to say is that you can never fight the fascistic agenda on their own narrative. While debunking their narrative, while exposing what they are saying is wrong, while completely saying that what they are saying is completely unrelated to facts and history, all that is correct, all that fight has to be done, but simultaneously the alternative public narrative has to be created. And that alternative public narrative comes from the basic point that we discussed earlier. The essence of fascistic agenda is to assist capitalism from emerging from its crisis by intensifying exploitation of the people. And the effects of that intensified exploitation of the people, that should form the basis for people's movement, which will be the alternative narrative. Today, the alternative narrative to Modi and to the RSS agenda, the most effective that is happening is your farmers' movement in Madhya Pradesh and in Maharashtra, and that is growing in other parts of northern India. The Maharashtra government had to announce this morning 30,000 crores of rupees worth of farm loans. Reluctantly, they had to accept. Our Kisan Sabha, our comrades who are leading, part of the leadership of that entire movement, they said, we will accept your assurance, but give you time till 25th of July. If you don't implement it, we are going to restart it. Now the Madhya Pradesh thing has moved towards Uttar Pradesh and to Haryana. The farmers issued the discontent, and because of this exploitation, those struggles, plus now what is happening with the youth of our country, 2 crores of jobs Mr. Modi promised every year. Today, your growth of employment in your industrial sector, in your 8 basic industries, is the lowest in the last 8 years. In these last 3 years, 3,62,000 jobs were created in our industrial sector. In 3 years, Modi's promise was 6 crore new jobs. Your REGA, government has admitted every year holding back wages of those who have already worked under REGA to the tune of 20,000 crores every year. That is more than 60,000 crores of rupees is not paid to people who have already worked under the rural employment scheme. Farmers, you said, the government itself admits to the Supreme Court that 12,000 farmers at least every year, that is 36 to 40,000 farmers have died officially, their own admission, through distress suicides that they were committing. Look at your great IT sector. As I told you, I was coming from Bangalore yesterday. Infosys, Cognizant and Wipro, 3 of your major IP companies, have announced a retrenchment of 56,000 people. Your IT industry today employs 40 lakhs of our youth, our most skilled and talented youth. McKinsey, the international agency, tells us that within the course of this year, 50 to 60% of this 40 lakhs employees will be rendered redundant, not retrenched. The technology is growing in such a way that our youth will be redundant for the new technology that is coming. So where is Skill India that Modi promised, that Digital India, that Skill India, if our own IT professionals are going to become redundant? What is happening to the country then? Industrial employment, rural employment, service sector employment, your most skilled educated sector employment. What is happening to your private educational colleges? I don't know about Kerala, but in other parts of the South India, in Andhra, we've just heard 72,000 seats are lying vacant in this year in the engineering colleges. Students are not going, parents are not sending because there are no jobs after becoming an engineer. Why blame Donald Trump that he's not allowing Indians to go? I mean, your own people, there are no jobs for them to go and opt. One father was telling me yesterday in Bangalore that he wanted his son to go into IT branch of engineering college. He said, no. He said, all my children. He said, then which branch do you want? He said, mechanical. I said, why mechanical? He said, some car or scooter will always get spoilt on the road, so I can at least get a job of becoming a mechanic. But in this IT, etc., there's no future. Now this is the situation, and it is on these issues that people's struggles will have to be mounted. And that is the manner in which, by creating the political alternative, the alternative narrative to the fascistic agenda, that this fascistic agenda must be fought. So that is why, to fight this fascistic agenda, why we have discussed. Now how to fight it is, while we meet the challenge that they pose philosophically, theoretically, mythologically, everywhere, which has to be answered, but the alternative narrative has to be created. And that is what is hitting them the most. Till now, after the UP election, there was only one narrative in the country, and that was the Modi narrative. Control over media. Sorry, I don't mean all of you, but I mean your owners, not the employees. Control over the media, and through that projection of only one narrative. But now, through people's struggles, the alternative narrative is emerging. The sham of that one-day hunger strike of the Madhya Pradesh chief minister. He sought on a hunger strike for one day, and next day he said, yes, there's no violence, therefore I withdraw my hunger strike. And why did that agitation take place? Because you promised. You promised loan waiver, you promised a minimum support price of 1.5 times the cost of production. Modi promised, BJP promised. 3 years you've not done it. Now these are the issues on which the alternative narrative is being built in the country, and that is the most effective way to fight this fascistic agenda. And that is why, for all of you in Kerala, and Kerala for India, is that this alternative, this fight against the fascistic forces, by creating a alternative political narrative, there Kerala has an important role to play. You're celebrating 60 years of the foundation of Kerala, which is the same as 60 years of the election of the first communist government anywhere in the world in a bourgeois democracy. That alternative political narrative, which since then, 60 years ago that you did, that in creating that alternative political narrative, Kerala will have to also play an important role in consolidating that alternative political narrative. And that is where Kerala will come under tremendous fire, because Kerala has the potential to contribute to that alternative narrative. That is why today, even though the left is not so strong as many other parties in parliament, why does the BJP concentrate its effort on the left? Why is it that since this last assembly elections in Kerala, the BJP is offensive, both in terms of political offensive and physical offensive? Why has it become so intense in Kerala to destabilize the LDF government? Today in Tripura, they're leaving no stone unturned to make sure that the left-wing government does not return to office in the elections that are there in early 2018. In Bengal, they're making all efforts, along playing tandem with the Trinamool Congress, to create competitive communalism. Trinamool Congress appealing to Muslim fundamentalism, which will make BJP in terms of Hindu consolidation. Through this process, they want to marginalize the left, because remember, Bengal has a very, very bloody history of communal strife at the time of partition. Mahatma Gandhi was not in Delhi when India became independent at the Red Fort with the hoisting of the Indian flag. He was in Calcutta on a hunger strike trying to stop the Noakhali communal riots. So they want to recreate that communal tension in Bengal so that the left can be marginalized. So the targeting of the left is important because they also realize that if there's anybody that can create this alternative political narrative, it is the left. And that is why Kerala is under specific target. And that you're all, by now, you're more accustomed and used to it. But then it is in these manners that we'll have to fight this fascistic agenda. And the most important is to create and erect that alternative political narrative which will be based on people's struggles, and those people's struggles will have to be strengthened, and that I think is the only way we can save India, to change India for the better, according to our understanding that we'll have to do. And as I said, you in Kerala will have a specific responsibility and a duty to do that, to create this alternative narrative. And I'm sure you'll do that. And history will be on our side. I'm confident about that. So with that confidence, I take leave of you. Thank you.